So I want to get to this. We're talking about releasing the mission of the Holy Ghost. Okay. Holy Spirit is on a mission. Say that with me. Holy Spirit. Say it again. Holy Spirit is on a mission. Holy Spirit has a mission. Holy Spirit has a mission, and that is to bring you into a place. That's to bring you into a place to where you can be effective in the kingdom of God. That you can be effective for the things that God has for your life. Holy Spirit has a mission for us to fulfill. He has a mission that He's assigned to your life for a specific purpose. Then He wants to deposit you and put you on a way to where you can fulfill your mission. Your mission is vital to the success of the kingdom of God in the earth. You fulfilling your purpose is vital to the success of the kingdom of God in the earth. You have to fulfill your mission if you want the kingdom of God to be as effective as God has designed it to be in the earth. Your mission matters. Just like your praise matter, just like your worship matter, your mission matters. Listen. Let me read the slide first. Look at this. It says this. I want to read the scripture. Luke 4:8. It says, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Philippians 3:3 says, For we are the circumcision which worship God in spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Those two words, serve and worship. Say that word with me. Say serve and worship. Those two words come from the same Greek word. Come from the same Greek word. To work and to worship is the one and the same in the mind of God. Your work is an expression of your worship. Your service to God is an expression of your worship. Your fulfilling of your destiny in life is an expression of your worship. There's no separation in God's mind. To worship God and to serve God, to work for God and to worship God is one and the same. If your work is not a demonstration of your worship, then you're doing the wrong thing. That's the major difference between your work, your occupation, your calling, and a job. It's not really what I'm supposed to be expressing toward God. My work should be an expression of my worship to God. I should love what I do. The same feeling I get when I'm sitting here worshiping God with my hands up and I'm singing should be the same feeling I get when I'm at work. Understand what that means. When I'm worshiping God and I'm feeling the goosebumps and I'm excited and my belly begins to churn and I'm excited about coming to work, it should be the same way when I go to work. It should be the same way when I go to fulfill my occupation, because it comes from the same Greek word. It's the same concept. In God's mind, your work is an expression of your worship to me. If you're not worshiping God, if you're not working and worshiping, then you're not doing and fulfilling the purpose for which God has sent you to fulfill. We have to understand that your work and your work is one. It should be one and the same. The life you get from worship, you should get from work. The energy you get from worship, you should get from work. The passion you have for worship, you should have for your work. And the people say, that's what it's about. Uh-oh. Your work and your worship is one and the same. That's why it's so critical for us to embrace what it is God has called us to do from a purpose perspective. Because my worship, my purpose, I'm simply extending my worship outside of the four walls of the room. When I'm worshiping God in here, it looks a certain way. How does worship in the sanctuary look? How does worship? Somebody give me a description. How does worship in the sanctuary look? Describe it for me. How does it look? Come on. How does it look? How does it sound? There's a sound to it. There's a look to it. There's a feel to it. What does it look like? Joyful. Huh? Joyful. Great. Joyful. What else? Beautiful. It is a beautiful thing. What else is it? Come on. What else does it look like? It sounds loud. It's loud. Right. Hands are lifted. People on their knees. There's a look. There's a feel. In the sanctuary, it looks a certain way. Worship should look a certain way. It should feel a certain way. It should sound a certain way. You know what? That's in this building. That's in the gathering of the saints. But once I get outside the sanctuary, it takes on a whole new structure, but it's still worship. It takes on a whole new face, but it's still my worship. It may take me administrating somebody's business. It may mean me operating the business as a CEO. It might mean managing a certain aspect of a business. It may look like teaching. It may look like instructing. It may look like being an advisor. It may, whatever it may look like, it's still an extension of my worship. That's why the very first thing that we need to be pursuing, that Holy Spirit, listen, that Holy Spirit will bring us into, is a awakening to the gift and the purposes for which God has called me. That's what Holy Ghost is going to do. He's going to reunite or reconnect us to the gifting and the calling that God has on our life, because he just wants you to continue your worship outside of the building. He wants you to worship every day. He wants you to live and breathe worship every single day. So the word worship and service and working is one and the same. Once we see that, that should give us a renewed passion to go after what it is God has called us to do. So give me a renewed passion. Listen, it gives me hope. It gives me hope. See, because when we in this building, when we gather together with the saints, we have a hope. There's a power that comes upon us in this building. On Sunday, faith is high. Hope is high. Energy levels are high. But come tomorrow, when I ain't around the saints, when I got to go to the job, everything just zaps out of me. But if you're walking in the purpose that God has for you, if you're fulfilling the mission that Holy Ghost reveals to you, then it won't be that way. That's why it's so critical. In my mind, and this is probably because of what I'm called to do, that's the end of it for me. That's the end of it. That's the end of it. The end is the purpose for which God saved me and graced me. That's the end. 4:18 says, I will pray the Father, and he shall give unto you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the Lord cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. And I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you, right? So this verse of scripture embodies just the beginning of what Holy Ghost was given unto us for. Next slide says, the other comforter is means as Jesus was. So Holy Ghost has come to continue and sustain the work of Passover. Understand it. Pentecost builds upon the work of Passover. Just because we don't amplify Passover, we amplify Pentecost now, does not mean we throw it aside. You're building upon the work of Pentecost, the book of Passover with Pentecost. Pentecost was given so that we can go further into the things that pertain to the kingdom of God, right? So the first thing is the root word, powerful thought here. And we'll close with this. Powerful thought here. We gotta embrace this. Okay, right. When Adam fell, a curse came upon man, right? A curse came upon mankind. Everybody understand that? A curse came. Man, the greatest curse is man's being separated from God, okay? Now, from that curse of separation came death and everything associated with death. I introduced the concept of entropy about a month or two ago. And that's the law where everything is built toward decay. It's bent toward decaying, right? Unless there's a force that comes against entropy, then everything eventually will die or dissipate, right? So there has to be a force exerted to supersede the entropy that's built into the world now. Chaos is built into society. Chaos will happen if you leave something to itself. It'll eventually become chaotic. So what we have to do is we have to embrace the solution, or find a solution to the chaos that's built into living life. So hence Holy Ghost, the curse. All this came through the curse of being separated from God. We lost the kingdom. Now the kingdom has been restored. Well, what happened? The root word for comforter, it means one to deliver. It means to deliver or break the curse. One who comes to break the curse in our life. Oh, that thing blessed my soul. Holy Ghost is one who's come to break the curse in your life. Say it with me. Holy Ghost has come to break the curse in my life. Holy Ghost has come to break the curse in your life. Pentecost is the curse breaker of your life. That's why we have to embrace Pentecost. He has come to cause us to overcome whatever curses have manifested through my lineage, through my family, through my bloodline, whatever I'm facing in today's society, whatever curse it is, Holy Ghost is empowered to break that curse. He's the curse breaker. I just saw him as an advocate, as a conductor, as a provider. But I saw the end of his work is to have you living in the blessed life that God has called you to live in. That's why Holy Ghost has come, to break the curse in your life. To break the curse in your life. We need the curse broken in our life. We don't only need the curse broken in our life. We need the curse broken in the lives of our loved ones and our families. We need it broken. But it's up to us to embrace all that Holy Spirit has for us. Yeah, he's our advocate. He advocates for us that he may conduct the affairs of our life, that he may bring us into, and that he may provide for us all that we have.